Hi everyone! In the previous video, we talked about how functional programming helps us to update an existing application. Today, I would like to present another benefit that goes against popular belief. FB is fantastic at managing complexity. I like this quote from Martin Odesky, the creator of Scala. Software systems get replaced not when they wear out, but when they crumble under their own weight, because they have become too complex. This is indeed a very common story. We write an application and add features over and over until it becomes unmaintainable. And then we rewrite the application from scratch, hoping that the story will not repeat itself. So how does functional programming help us to tackle complexity? Well, FP functions are extremely simple. They are essentially black boxes where input values go in and a single output value comes out. This type of function is very straightforward to test. We don't need complex setup operations or mocking frameworks. We only need to provide the inputs and then check that the output matches our expectation. FP functions are also highly composable. We can build complex functions by creating a pipeline of smaller functions. This can be linear or not. Several functions' output can converge into a single function, or the other way around. Technically, a function can only return a single value. But if it produces a tuple, then that's essentially several values packaged together. In a sense, programming with FP function is like plumbing, which is very convenient for debugging an application. If you wonder why a function produces a particular output, you can follow the pipes to investigate the source of the problem. Dependencies are clearly laid out because functions are deterministic, which means that the output of a function can only depend on its inputs. Now, this sounds great on paper, but it's difficult to see how it impacts our work. So let's go through a concrete example to contrast using FP and non-FP functions. Say we are a developer on an e-commerce website, such as Amazon. A typical customer workflow on this platform would entail selecting a few items, entering their payment and delivery details, before finally confirming the order. Our job will be to generate an invoice for an order, which should look like this. The invoice contains a line for each item and the total for the entire order, both before and after taxes. On the header of the invoice, we need to include the customer's name and address, our company's address, the invoice number, and the date at which we generated the document. We'll skip over producing the actual document and instead focus on the interface. Essentially, we need to implement a function that accepts 1. An order which contains the relevant information about each product, such as the price and the quantity. 2. A customer's record containing their name and address. Then the function must output a file, perhaps a PDF, representing the invoice. Now, what do you think is wrong with this design? Take a minute or two to think about it. There are several issues. The first we'll consider is testing. How are we going to test this function? We could generate a couple of invoices and manually check that they look as we expect. Then we could save these files in our codebase and write a test for each of them. For example, if the order is order 1 and the customer's name is Bob, we might expect to get the file invoice-bob-1.pdf. This is called a golden test, and it's commonly used for checking the result of a public API. For example, we might want to verify that we didn't accidentally rename the key of a JSON document. However, this technique won't work here because generate invoice is not deterministic. In particular, the invoice number and today's date are not passed as inputs of the function. Either they are fetched from a mutating variable or from the runtime. This means that we can't compare the result of generate invoice against a static file, because every time we call this function, we would expect to receive a different invoice with a different invoice number and potentially a different date. The solution to this problem is well known in the programming community. If we want to test a function easily, we need to pass all its dependencies as parameters. This is called dependency injection. And in FP, we don't need to think about it, because all FP functions are deterministic. They cannot depend on a mutating variable or read rows from a database. So by default, all FP functions must use dependency injection. Now, putting testing aside, I would like to show you another issue with the original design of generate invoice. Let's say that our employer, the e-commerce platform, wants to make its website available in different languages. For example, English and French. This means that for each order, we need to generate the corresponding invoice in two languages. That said, we'll only need to update the document's titles and headers. The items inside the order and the currency won't be affected. As an experienced developer, you might think, okay, that's not a big deal. We can tweak the existing generate invoice function by adding an extra argument representing the invoice's desired language. Then internally, we can select a file template for this language. Great. Once we have done that, we can generate the same invoice in English and French by calling generateInvoice twice. Next, we'll wrap everything into a new function, generateInvoices, a plural, which takes an order and a customer and dispatches these arguments to the two internal functions. This will give us two files, one in English and one in French. We can either put both files together into a tuple or case classes, or we can add an extra zip operation at the end and return a single file. Either approach is suitable depending on the business case. Okay, great job everyone. With limited effort, we have successfully internationalized the invoices for our e-commerce platform. Now we send a pull request, push the feature to our test environment, and if we're lucky, a tester will find a bug in our code. What do you think it is? It's really easy to miss. But when generating an invoice, we fetch the current invoice number from the environment, and then we increment it. Otherwise, we would be using the same invoice number for all documents. The problem is, we are generating two versions of the same invoice, and we require the same invoice number on both. In other words, we want the language to change between the English and French versions, but not the data inside the invoice. This bug may not seem dramatic, but it might cause some issues for our payment department, because customers will only pay one of the two invoices. For example, suppose a customer makes a bank transfer using the French invoice number. In that case, the English invoice will eventually be marked as overdue. Anyway, the most important takeaway is that actions makes it difficult to build complex functions from simpler ones. In this example, generate invoice in English impacts the behavior of generate invoice in French. But if we look at the diagram, there is no arrows connecting these two functions. This information is not visible in the signature of the function. It might only be known to the developer who implemented it. This is fine when the code base is small. We can remember a few of these undocumented effects, but it becomes far more difficult as the code base grows. Eventually, it leads to bugs and to applications that are very difficult to extend. And this is often why it takes so long for new team members to become productive. It's not because they lack experience building software, but because they need to learn a vast amount of knowledge specific to this project. So, how does functional programming help us in this situation? There are several solutions, but I would first suggest to clearly express all the inputs and outputs of generate invoice. For example, we can add the invoice number and today's date as parameters. And as we discovered earlier, this will help with testing. We can also change the return type of the function to produce a file and the next invoice number. This way, if we need to generate several invoices for different orders, we can pass the next invoice number to the following phase. I would also look to execute file generation as late as possible in the process. For example, the function could return a case class that describes all the data inside the invoice, including the customer's address, and calculations such as the total before and after taxes. This will help tremendously in testing because it's much simpler to compare case classes than files. Additionally, we can reuse the invoice object to generate both the English and French document. For instance, we could have a function that looks up a template for a given language, in which case generate invoice would only be in charge of filling in placeholders using the invoice object. Finally, we can zip all the invoices files together and return the zip file along with the next invoice number. This design is 100% functional, all functions are total, deterministic, and they don't perform any actions. Writing into a file is an action, but we don't really do that here. When I say that generate invoice produces a file, I mean that it creates an immutable binary object representing a file. And you can find this kind of data structure in several libraries, such as ACA or S-Codec. Rather than attribute this success to FP, you might argue that this is a good design because we use sound software practices, such as dependency injection and the single responsibility principle, which state that a function should do only one thing. And I would completely agree with you. FP is not a silver bullet. It will not solve all our problems, not replace years of experience building software. You can't very well arrive at the same result following OOP design patterns. Yet, because they are so limited, FP functions forces us to clearly document all the dependencies and effects. And as a result, we are pushed toward a solution that is both easier to test and easier to build on top of. In summary, today we explore the difference between an FP and a non-FP function. Essentially, FP function imposes two restrictions. One, we can't fetch data from the environment. Instead, we need to pass all the dependencies as arguments of the function. Two, we can't perform any actions. Instead, we need to describe all the effects made by the function in the output values. Additionally, we can see why actions are also called side effects. This is because they are not standard outputs of the function, rather than actions come out from the side. We have also seen how those limitations help us to tackle complexity. First, functions are much easier to test because dependency injection is a default. Second, it's easier to build complex programs because we don't need to remember implementation details, such as when generate invoice increments a variable. Finally, it's faster to onboard new developers because they have less project-specific knowledge to learn as function signature is used as documentation. Additionally, this documentation cannot get out of sync because the compiler ensures that it stays accurate. Cool, so I hope you enjoy watching these videos as much as I enjoy making those diagrams. And I hope to see you soon for the next episode. Don't forget to check out my website, fp-tower.com, to get access to all my functional programming content and sign up for my course. See you soon.